record now. Okay, so it's recording right
Yeah,
now.
so then you send us recording also later.
Yes, yes, I'll try my level best.
Okay,
okay, okay. So
awesome.
Before we really discuss today's lecture, let's talk about my introduction. My name is Sayyid Ali Hussain, and I have done honors from Rawalpindi Medical College, and I've done masters in orthopedic manual physical therapy from Rifa College of Rehabilitation Sciences, Rifa International University. And recently I've done postgraduate diploma in teaching methodologies and medical ethics. Currently, I'm the president of Pakistan Association of Orthopedic Manipulative Physical Therapists. I'm consultant therapist at Max Health Hospital Spine Center. I also served as principal at Women Institute of Rehabilitation Sciences, Abbottabad, and I'm currently a permanent faculty member at Rifa College of Rehabilitation Sciences, Islamabad. And the topic of our presentation today is introduction about human spine and some of its pathologies. Before we really discuss spine, we need to have an understanding of what spine is and what is the skeletal system. So the bony framework of human body is called skeleton, and the human body has 206 bones. And the skeletal system is divided for understanding into two different parts. One is called the axial skeleton and the other one is called as appendicular skeleton. This is the complete human skeletal system. We can see some bones, the whole of the skeletal system, the skull. I hope you can see my cursor moving over here.
Yes, we can see.
Okay, so this is the skull. These are the vertebrae, the ribs, the upper extremities, the lower extremities, and the pelvic girdles. And we'll discuss almost every feature of the spine in a bit while. So axial skeleton, means the skeleton which is present in the long axis of the body, and it basically consists of the skull, the vertebral column, the ribs, the sternum, which is also called as the breastbone. And in this picture we can see the highlighted portion or the red portion of the skeleton is the axial skeleton, and the rest of the skeleton is appendicular skeleton. Now, appendicular skeleton is basically, it is the appendages of the body, and the appendages, they means extensions, and for human body, the extensions are upper and lower limbs or extremities. And there is an important feature of the skeletal system which is called as girdle. Basically, this girdle is a junction between the axial and the appendicular skeleton. And there are two girdles in the body. One in the upper extremity is called as the shoulder girdle, and for the lower extremity it is called as the pelvic girdle. Now the red portion of the skeleton, this is all the appendicular skeleton. Now coming to the spine, it is also called as the vertebral column. The human spine has 24 vertebrae according to one classification, the one I followed, but according to another classification, they say that the human spine consists of 33 vertebrae. And there are 7 cervical vertebrae in the neck. The thoracic vertebrae are 12 in number, and they are in the upper back. And there are 5 lumbar vertebrae, the lower back. There is one sacrum, which is the 5 fused vertebrae, and a tailbone, which is called as coccyx. It is 4 fused vertebrae. So these are total 24 vertebrae, and there are 23 intervertebral discs in the spine. In this picture, we can see the lateral view or the side view of the human spine. This is the thoracic cervical region, and we can see from 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, and 7 cervical vertebrae. There are 7 cervical vertebrae, the 12 thoracic vertebrae, 5 lumbar vertebrae. These are the sacral vertebrae, and this is the coccyx. And over here, we can see a big picture of the vertebrae. We can see the vertebral body. We can see the spinous process over here. We can see the facets and superior articular processes and inferior articular processes. We are going to discuss these in detail in the later slides. Now talking about the vertebra, it is single, it is called as vertebra, and plural is vertebrae. So it's a Latin word which means to turn, and it is the functional and structural unit of spinal column. And basically they are also classified into typical vertebras and atypical vertebra. Talking about the typical vertebra, a typical vertebra has the following features. It has a body, it has a vertebral foramen, a spinous process, a transverse process, superior and inferior articular processes, and the pedicles, and lastly the lamina. Over here we can see this is the portion of the vertebra which is called as the vertebral body, and it is in contact with the intervertebral disc. And the area of the vertebra between the vertebral body and the transverse process is called the pedicle, and the area of the vertebra which is between the transverse process and the spinous process is called as the lamina. And in between the pedicle and the lamina and the transverse process, we have superior and inferior articulating facets which articulate with adjacent vertebras. And these processes like the transverse process, the spinous process, they are there for the attachment of different muscles and ligaments, and they act as lever in the spine. This is the vertebral foramen, and this is really very important because a very critical structure of the central nervous system, which is spinal cord, it runs all the way till the L1 or L2 vertebra in the spinal column. Now talking about the typical vertebras of the body, because they all share the same features which we discussed earlier, C2 to C6 and then T1 to T12 and L1 to L5, S1 to S2 and coccygeal 1 to 4. Atypical vertebras, basically any vertebra who has any special process or feature other than the above mentioned processes, they are considered as atypical vertebras. And any vertebra who lack all the features of a typical vertebra, it may have one more feature or one less feature, they can termed as atypical vertebras. For example, in this picture we can see first cervical vertebra which is called as atlas, and the second cervical vertebra which is called as axis. Now if we look at this vertebra over here, the C1, it lacks a vertebral body, and there are two arches, anterior arch and posterior arch, and these arches are joined by two lateral masses, and these lateral masses are absent in all vertebras, they are only present in C1 vertebra. And in the transverse process we can see there is a foramen which is called as foraminal transverse area, which is a feature of cervical vertebras, but this vertebra is one and only vertebra, like no other vertebra in the body is like this. And if you look at the second cervical vertebra, it does have a vertebral body, it has a spinous process, it has the same transverse process, but it has an additional feature which is called as dens, or sometimes it is referred to as odontoid process. It is basically a process around which this first vertebra or the neck of the human body moves, and basically it's sort of a joint which is pivot joint. Now talking about the atypical vertebras, the first cervical vertebra has no body and the spinous process, and C2 has an additional dense process, and C7 sometime in 70% of the population it is termed as vertebra prominence because it has the longest spinous process of all the cervical vertebras. And in 30% of the population's T1, which is thoracic first vertebra, it can be called as the vertebra prominence. And there's a simple trick to differentiate either we are looking at the C7 or T1. If the person is moving his neck and you feel the vertebra is moving, if the spinous process is moving or the vertebra is moving, then this vertebra is C7, and if the vertebra is not moving, then this vertebra will be T1. You can ask me any question if you like.
Yeah, definitely they will.
Okay, so talking about the intervertebral disc, it is sandwiched between the two adjacent vertebras, and it is a fibrocartilaginous disc. Basically, the function of this disc is to act as a cushion, and it gives the shapes and curves to the human spine. And there is an exception that there is no disc present between the C0 and C1, which is atlanto-axial joint and atlanto-occipital joint and the coccyx. And there is also no disc present between the sacral bones. Here we can see on this view these two adjacent vertebras and the intervertebral disc between them. This blue colored disc is present, and it has two parts. The outer portion is called as the annulus fibrosus, and the inner portion is called as nucleus pulposus. Now, the annulus fibrosus, basically these are almost 90 concentric bands of rings, and the inner portion is nucleus. The nucleus is semi-solid or gelatinous material which is incompressible, and 95% of this nucleus pulposus is basically water. So the structures that hold the vertebra together are the ligaments and the muscles. And if we look at the ligaments of the spine, there is anterior longitudinal ligament, which is one of the longest ligament of the body. It is present anteriorly on the vertebral column. Then there is posterior longitudinal ligament. If we talk about their strength, then anterior longitudinal ligament is a bit strong as compared to the posterior longitudinal ligament, which is relatively weak as compared to anterior longitudinal ligament. Then there are supraspinous ligaments, interspinous ligament, intertransverse ligaments, and ligamentum flavum, which is also called as the yellow ligament. Now, if you look at this picture, we can see these are the vertebral bodies over here. These are vertebral bodies all the way down, and in between these vertebral bodies, we can see the intervertebral discs over here, and over here. Anteriorly, this is the vertebral body is on the anterior side, and anteriorly we can see this is anterior longitudinal ligament. It runs all the length of the spine from the occiput to the sacrum, and posteriorly in the vertebral canal we can see the posterior longitudinal ligament. It is same like anterior longitudinal ligament, just it's a bit weaker and it's present on the posterior aspect of the vertebral body. Then we can see the supraspinous ligament, which is present on top of the spinous processes, and in the cervical region, this supraspinous ligament is called as the nuchal ligament. In between the spinous processes, there is a ligament which is called as interspinous ligament, and we can see over here, this is the interspinous ligament. Then we can see intertransverse ligament, which is not over here, but there is a ligament between the transverse processes of two adjacent vertebra. And lastly, we can see the ligamentum flavum over here. And ligamentum flavum is really very important because clinically and biomechanically, it is the only ligament in the body which can be stretched up to 100% of its resting length. And it has most elastic fibers in as compared to any other ligament in the body. Okay, coming on the muscles of the spine, the muscles, they can be categorized into global muscles and the core muscles. Global muscles, they are multi-segmental, like they originate from, let's say, from the ilium and they insert on the thoracic. They originate from the ilium and insert on lumbar. So they have multi-segmental origin and insertion, and they are responsible to produce the gross movements of the spine like flexion and extension. Then there are core muscles. The core muscles, they are called the core muscles because they originate and insert from the same segment, and they are responsible for providing stability and support. If we talk about the joints, in the cervical and the lumbar region, the two adjacent vertebra, they make three joints. The first joint is between the two adjacent vertebral bodies, and it is symphyseal joint. It permits a very small amount of movement. And on the posterior side, we have two plane gliding joints, which are synovial in nature, and they are also called as the facet joints. And the purpose of these joints is to guide the movement. And in addition to the symphyseal joint and facet joints, the thoracic spine is exception because it has the following articulations. It has costovertebral joints, four on each vertebral body, and costotransverse joint, one on each side of the vertebra. And a motion segment at the thoracic spine has nine joints as compared to the rest of the spine. Like in the cervical spine and the lumbar spine, we have only three joints. But in the thoracic spine, we have nine joints, and this is the reason that the thoracic spine is a lot stiffer as compared to the cervical and the lumbar spine. They are a lot mobile as compared to the thoracic spine. Now, degree of the freedom, the spine has three degree of freedom. It can move in all three planes. They can be the movements of flexion and extension, right and left side bending, and right and left rotation. And there are some other movements or motions which are called, I've not mentioned them here because it's totally a physiotherapeutic point of view, but there are coupled movements and non-coupled movements as well. Like in the spine, we believe, the physiotherapy community, they believe that, and even the chiropractors, that whenever we perform side bending, there is adjunct or conjunct rotation. So I'm not discussing it over here, but for just the purpose of understanding and merely distributing knowledge, we can say that there are some other motions or movements that can occur on the spine as well. If we talk about the ranges of the spine, let's talk about cervical spine active range of motion. Flexion is 50 degrees. It is measured with a device which is called as inclinometer. A bubble inclinometer or a digital inclinometer can be used, and the person or the patient is asked to perform the cervical flexion with his own muscles. In extension, we have greater range as compared to the flexion, and it is 60 degrees. And the range of side bending is 45 degrees on each side. And the rotation range of motion is almost 70 to 80 degrees, and it varies from person to person. All these ranges, they can vary from person to person, and with age and with gender and with occupational status and habits and everything. But these are just reference ranges. If we talk about the normal thoracic spine ranges, active range of motion, then flexion is 60 degrees, extension is 25 degrees. It is relatively low as compared to the cervical spine, and side bending is 25 degrees, and rotation is only 30 degrees. In the lumbar spine has most free movement of flexion and extension. Not extension that much, but flexion too much, like 60 degrees, and extension is 25 degrees. Side bending is 25 degrees, but there is no rotation because the orientation of the facets of the lumbar spine, it is vertical, or it's 90 degree or right angle to each other, so to the horizontal, so they do not permit the rotation. If you look at the spine is not like a bamboo. It's a bit curved, and there are curves of the spine which are called as primary curves and secondary curves. So the primary curves, they are present at birth, and they are the thoracic curves and the sacral curve, and both of these are convex posteriorly. And then there are secondary curves which are developed with neck holding and standing. And they are termed secondary because they are not present at the time of birth. These curves are cervical and the lumbar, and they are concave posteriorly, and they are the reverse of these two curves, like thoracic and sacral. There are total 31 pairs of spinal nerves, and 8 of them are in cervical spine. It is worth remembering that the cervical spine has 7 vertebrae, but the number of nerves that pass from them are 8. The thoracic spine has 12 vertebrae and they permit 12 nerves to pass through them, and the lumbar spine has 5 nerves. The sacral spine also has the 5 nerves and the coccygeal has 1 nerve. So all of them make 31 nerves. If we talk about weight distribution in the spine, then the vertebral body is the major weight like bearing portion of the vertebra, and it bears as much as 60% of the weight, and the facet joints, they contribute to 30% of weight bearing, and other structures like ligaments and the muscles, they are responsible for 10% of weight bearing in the spine. Let's talk about some functions of the human spine. So the vertebral body, it is a source of erythropoiesis, that red blood cells throughout the human life, they are being produced from the vertebral body, because it is it contains red bone marrow and it does not turn into yellow bone marrow. The vertebra or the spine, it protects the vital structure like spinal cord, which is really very important and essential for mobility and other vital functions. It provides mobility and absorbs shock. It transmits the weight of upper limbs to the ground, and it provides a mechanical linkage between the upper limbs and the lower limbs. Let's talk about some pathologies of the spine. Because the human spine is subjected to vigorous forces and it is mobile, it remains mobile throughout the human life, if not diseased, then it has the greater tendency to develop mechanical and non-mechanical pathologies as well. With the term mechanical, I mean those pathologies which are due to the mechanical reasons, like more stress and wear and tear, and non-mechanical, they refer to some pathologies that are caused by some pathogens like microorganisms or bacteria and things like that.
Dr. Ali, can I interrupt you for a minute?
Yes, sure.
Yeah, one of my students would like something, so I can invite her here. So she would like to ask me something.
Okay.
Hi, I'm Delphi.
Hi.
I have a question.
Yes.
What is the relation of aponeurosis to skeletal system?
What is the relation of aponeurosis to the skeletal system? Okay. Aponeurosis basically...
Yeah.
Aponeurosis, they are basically the flattened sheet-like structure of a muscle. Like they are not contractile, but they are basically... more of you can say fibrous in nature. They are not contractile, and we see aponeurosis at the transversus abdominis muscle, external and internal oblique muscles, and we see that most of the fibers of these muscles, they blend together to form a sheath like structure. I hope that you understand what is meant by sheath. Okay, so I hope you got your answer, because like they are joined, and there is maybe let me add something also. There is something called as enthesis. It is the point where a skeletal muscle or a soft tissue is attaching to the like articular system, to the bone. So maybe this can also add up to your answer, that the skeletal system, it is giving support or anchorage to the muscular system. The muscles, they are basically you can say like springs. They produce movements, but they can only pull. They create a pull, they cannot create push. So they are being anchored to the muscle and to the bones. If they are not anchored to the bone, they can't contract, they can't produce any movement.
Okay, thank you so much.
Welcome.
Now you can continue.
Okay.